This Seed Story Cop story. Nearly 2 years ago, the story began. The second time was even bigger. The third cuff was
welcome back, everybody.
Legendary. We teased you, but here it is. Bigger, better, sicker. Welcome to Seed Story Cup 4.
Okay, hello everyone, and welcome to Seed Story Cup number 4, live from Krefeld, Germany. We're actually in the new location of Take TV. I'm joined by Frodan, of course. How are you doing, buddy?
What's up? Welcome once again, everybody, to Seed Story Cup. I'm glad to be here. I've been here since the very beginning, and I'm really happy to be back.
Yeah, it's really cool to be here finally in the new location. We've already had one event here, but this is the first Seed Story Cup, actually.
Yeah, that's right. So for everybody who's been watching Seed Story in the past, the venue looks very different. If you look around, it's a full-out bar and lounge. The reason why is because Take TV officially moved. This is what we did at Seed Story Cup 3, where we had a big Kickstarter, and you guys were wondering, like, what are you guys donating exactly to? It was to create an environment like this so that Take can do things that are even bigger. So not only Seed Story, but people come here all the time to just have gaming events, whether or not they're watching Barcraft stuff or big things like WCS going on or, you know, another big HWC event. They can come here and hang out. And that's what we're having, a Seed Story Cup number 4. And so far, it's been really fun.
Yeah, exactly. And also, fans can engage with the players so much better here, right? Because it's all on, like, one level here. We're upstairs next to the bar. Players can just come here, talk to the players. It's pretty awesome. They're actually downstairs in the VIP area, playing some poker, hanging out, prepping for the games.
So you think they're supposed to be preparing, but right now you can see on your screen, they're actually playing a lot of Overwatch. They're hanging out. They're just being really loose in general, because right now the whole point of Seed Story Cup is that, with Take TV, esports always comes home. So you're supposed to be in a very environment where you're relaxed, where you're having fun, you're with your peers. You might see a lot of players you don't normally interface with. They get to show their personality off, their casting with us. They're doing fun segments. It's going to be a really good time. So if you haven't watched Seed Story Cup 4, make sure that you're trying to tune in. Just have it on in the background. You're going to see a lot of things that you don't normally see in tournaments, and it's a hell of an entertaining event.
For sure. I mean, I can promise we have a lot of fun shenanigans planned, as always. We're kind of famous for that, I guess.
Yep. Well, a couple of weird things happen there and there, but bear with us, because that's part of the charm of the event.
Exactly. A lot of fun stuff planned, as we said. We actually have the first match coming up rather soon on the main stream right here. It's going to be Ekoff versus RDU.
Yep. That's right. We apologize for starting off late. We just had some internet issues, but we want to make sure that everything goes smoothly. And so we're going to have our first match. The way it happens is we have 32 players who are going to break down in groups. And the first is RDU versus Ekoff. I think I wanted to introduce them because some people might not know who they are. So let's go ahead and turn the camera and see who we're talking about exactly. So on the left, we have RDU. RDU, do a cool pose. I said cool. And Ekoff doing the Ekoff pose. None of these guys particularly looking too cool about it. But it's all right. So let's go ahead and talk about them. So RDU, how are you doing, man? How's everything been so far for you?
Really good. I practiced a lot, and I'm really hyped to play in this event. And I want to do better than last time.
Yeah, actually, last time, RDU performed the worst in Seed Story Cup. He didn't get a single win. In fact, you were the only person to do that. And then the second worst person was me, of course. I got one win. So, RDU, how is it this different this time around for you?
I just practiced a lot more. And I think it's a better format. I like last year's standing a lot.
Oh, that's right. We're not doing Conquest this tournament because, you know, now that HWC is over, we don't have to really worry about that kind of stuff. We're going to do last year's standing one band, just like good old times. Does that give you an advantage at all, Ekoff?
Yeah, of course. I mean, I've been dominant last year's standing tournaments in the past, like, in 2014, back in the day, yeah. It's been a while. I'm really happy to go back to last year's standing for sure.
That's right. All right, well, we'll see what you guys have to say. Do you have anything you want to talk to RDU about? Like, say anything before the match?
To RDU? I'm sorry for your loss, bro.
All right, well, we'll have much better trash talk as the day develops, because right now it's been pretty light. But we're introing with that. Bastion, I'm pretty sure we're ready to open the show. Did you want to cover anything before we start?
Not really. I guess that with the delay, we kind of want to see matches now, right? So yep. I guess we can just throw it over to the couch. Players can get ready. And Lothar, Noxious, and you, Froden, are going to be casting.
I got to walk over. So hang tight, guys. We'll be right back and just starting in just a second.
Exactly. See you guys.
Turn over to the couch, man. Frodo's going to be coming over for sure. He's going to be in the middle, probably, between us. There's not that much room.
I think so.
But That's fine.
Yeah, well, we can squeeze in, or we just, I don't know.
No, the frame's good enough. I can see Frodan's coming over very casually with the Hearthstone shirt. Yep, I knew it. The bro
kiss
hug.
Kiss can.
Okay, I'm going to be in the middle, I guess.
Can you take this?
Here we go. Do you want mine? It's like closer.
What up?
Hi, Frodan.
Hi.
How you doing?
Maybe you're going
to doing all right.
You got good hair.
I'm actually a little out of breath. That took a lot of athletic ability.
Yeah, and, climbing over the couch.
Yeah, I summed up all of my muscles and power.
Sure did.
So, hope it impressed you.
Yeah.
You're That's not right. fitting the color scheme, Frodan.
The what? The purple thing?
No. Black.
Oh, okay, red, gotcha. The Hearthstone.
I was gray, but then I switched. I guess if, like, I'm kind of the middle ground. See?
Are we actually live? Or
yeah, we're live.
Oh, okay. Because I thought we're waiting for the show.
So
my microphone, for some reason, is all the way over here. But
yeah, that's why I asked you. Do you
want
mine?
Can switch, you know?
Yeah, no. Oh, yeah, we should probably switch. Here we go.
It's a recap. We can do this stuff.
Wait, no. Now my mic's even farther away. Oh, no, it's right here.
But that's like...
Yeah, you know those, like, basic coloring books where, like, you're supposed to trace back where every single wire is? I always failed at that. So.
Yeah, it's all right, Frodan.
Yeah, I lack these basic motor skills. Well, greetings, everybody, from the casting couch here at Seed Story Cup 4. We're live from Krefeld, Germany, and it's time to begin the journey to see who can take this tournament. It's right. A lot on the line. There's $20,000, and the coolest part is that Seed Story, for some reason, has a lot of interesting things surrounding the tournament. Last time we were here, Black Rock Mountain was coming out.
Yeah.
And this time around, League of Explorers is coming out mid-tournament. It's the
exactly
same exact
the same
scenario.
Situation.
Yeah.
So we'll be not having League of Explorers for the group stage.
Right, because it's not even out yet officially. So, like, we can't even have the cards for the tournament to start. But for the round of 16 onwards, meaning day 3, we're going to have it completely playable from the Wing 1. So that includes Reno Jackson, Unearthed Raptor, I believe.
Forgotten Torch. Which with Reno Jackson, I think you could see both in the same deck.
Yeah, for sure. Like a lot of the one-off. So it's a very exciting time for people who love not only this tournament, but also love seeing the new cards with some of the players who are very innovative. We don't, you know, we can be realistic here. We don't have a lot of the players that we're normally seeing that has huge names, right?
Yeah.
We don't have a Maz. We don't really have Forsen. You know, Krip was here last time, but he didn't really make it. But that's okay because the people that are here are very talented players, and I can't wait to see more of that side of them. They get to cast more often. You know, like guys like Firebat and Gaara, they've been casting a lot more in recent times. So I'm excited to see what they have because that's what the C-Story is about. It's more
guest
about
casting, right?
The players.
You just like hop on as a player and they can talk without being formally invited. And Firebat, you know, the few times he's actually been casting events like formally, I guess, he's actually really good at it. And I feel like that's just because pro players just have great insight in general. And he's gotten a lot better at
You look great on camera.
I know, man.
He's looking down. I don't even know, man. That POV.
I could do
that POV.
That
is
POV
arousing.
On the casting couch, Frodan. You're going too far.
It's sensational.
It's casting couch anyway.
Well,
there we go. I think this is gonna be a lot better.
That's great.
I feel
great.
Better too.
So, Noxious, I believe you're the only person that's here that's you know, a personality that's not playing in the event. Before it was supposed
right.
to be me and you, but yeah. I'm also playing too because I got suckered in
well,
based
I could
off Raid
play,
canceling
I guess,
last
technically.
Second.
Will you make a new patch?
I could totally play though.
You'll see.
I could play.
You could play, but I'll save you a lot of
do they have
and embarrassment. Don't.
No, but I have Aggro Priest lined up, and I actually perfected it.
Yeah, well, I mean, Lothar's playing too. Lothar's been casting a lot these days. Nimsh is casting almost exclusively these days, but he's also competing.
Much.
So, you know, everyone recognizes that Seed Story is, again, it's an event about, like, playing. It's about the atmosphere. It's more the fact that if you hear really closely into the background, you can't really notice it right now because behind us is
They're
the general
downstairs.
Population. But it's, like, downstairs, it's super crowded. The players are always talking, whether about Hearthstone, you know, giving each other tips, or playing poker and taking each other's money.
Or playing Overwatch.
Or playing Overwatch. I mean, that's what we were doing, like, you know, an hour before this event started. And we've been having a lot of fun with that.
True.
So have you been playing more Overwatch than Hearthstone recently, Lothar?
Well, I usually play Hearthstone when I'm streaming. So when I'm streaming, there's, like, over 100 hours per month. But when I have my laptop while traveling, so Overwatch was a companion.
That's true. You were playing a lot of BlizzCon because it was the fresh thing. It was pretty odd.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like at BlizzCon, it just reinforced. I mean, the expansion coming out so fast after BlizzCon kind of makes me want to play Hearthstone more.
Yeah, no, for
I
sure.
feel like there if there had been a longer downtime, I might have felt maybe a little more incentivized to just play Overwatch, but.
No worries, man. I'm excited to see how League of Explorers pans out. I think we got some really exciting cards to see what's going to happen. You know, a lot of people are talking about week. Like...
It's on the first week, right?
Yeah, it's only the first week. That's what people are always talking about. They're like, we want constant balance patches and changes. And it's like, well, Adventure is technically kind of like release
for
things
a month
weekly
and a half,
for like 6 weeks. So you have that experience of like things slightly tweaking and slightly changing. Mm-hmm. And we've had two of them so far. So to a certain extent, we've gotten what we wanted. Yeah. The only thing is that League is less wings, but more cards. So I think that's what's really interesting.
Yeah, I like the way they did it. I feel like so far it's probably my favorite adventure mode. Probably my favorite set. Like,
you haven't even played it. How do you even know?
No, just the cards themselves.
Oh, okay.
I feel like the cards themselves, like that, what they do, it feels to me like the coolest set they've had. Because GVG, I mean, it did bring a lot of cool stuff, but I don't feel like it brought any new mechanics. They brought mechs, but that was it pretty much. So.
Well, I mean, there's some weird ones like the ogres 50%. Chance. That was fun.
Right, yeah, that was cool for like 2 minutes until you started. It never hits, so you're like, a 2 minute 4-4 looks pretty legit, but then,
And then GVG also introduced like true class bleeding, like unstable portal and stuff like that, which is just, you know, shenanigans. Anyways, guys, cool. We've gotten really off topic. The reason why is because we're waiting for the first game to start,
well,
and like we're just stalling. But I think we can take this opportunity to get ready to go into game number one. We didn't really get to show the groups, but I guess we'll do that.
Yeah, sure.
Afterwards,
yeah.
We're supposed to do that as proper hosts.
Proper hosts.
We're supposed to show the groups. We're supposed to talk
I'm
about
the guest
like schedules.
Here. You're the host.
I'm
Wait,
the host.
You're the player too.
All right. Well, right now I have chat pulled up, which is probably a very bad idea.
Yeah, I get distracted a lot. All
right.
Chat spam Kappa 1-2.
Okay. So let's go ahead and walk through. If you just started watching Hearthstone this year, you might be familiar with the normal format, which is conquest, meaning that you have to win with each of your deck. But we're doing last hero standing.
Which means if you win,
comic,
you can replay this.
Style.
That's
Watch
very
out.
Cool.
Actually, yeah. I saw that graphic, cling, and cling. I was like, that is very comic book style.
Did you see those banners in the players' areas?
Oh, that's sweet.
That's actually really cool.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
I mean, I just saw it right now.
I'm actually going to try to see if I can get something like that done for
me. It reminds me of, what's that game, that tabletop game, Sentinels of the Multiverse?
Yeah.
It's the exact same aesthetic.
I want a two for my place.
Gotcha. Well, we have... Last hero standing means it's King of the Hill. Whatever class you win with, you have to stick on. And the loser has to answer it. So hypothetically, if this druid wins the one game, it can win 3 games. It can win 4 games and ultimately a sweep. It's a best of 5. And they do get 1 ban by bringing 4 decks. Mm-hmm. Therefore, the other 3 decks are available.
Yeah. And when the people advance to the top 8, they can use a 5th deck.
That's right.
Right.
That's right. So they say, but I've never gotten anywhere near that. So we're going to start with Druid versus Hunter, but it's not just a regular Druid. It is the aggressive Druid, which has gotten very popular recently, particularly because, one, it's very hard to anticipate this type of Druid all the time. It can surprise people with fast damage and Fel Reavers with Savage Roar. And the second part of it is... it actually does do decently well against the metagame with, you know, Paladins.
Right. What's interesting, too, is that sometimes they just ignore, like, they don't really trade nearly as much as, you know, typical mid-range would. Mm-hmm. And just because they've got the insurance of the combo, then they don't mind doing so. It's a really weird deck. I'm surprised it took so long to emerge, because it seems like it could have worked a long time ago.
Yeah.
And I have to wonder if maybe Druid of the Saber wasn't, like, the 2-drop that they were waiting for. When it came out.
Well, it makes sense. It's a lot of versatility with the charge, as well as even putting it in stealth. It's not the fact that it's a 3-2. It's the fact that it's stealth.
It doesn't die. You're
Therefore, you can pick your attack accordingly. You can see that... I'm actually kind of confused who is who, because it says Ecos on the left, but is he the one playing Hunter? I would assume so, because RDU really loves Hunter, and in fact, RDU is one of those weird guys who says Hunter versus Hunter is his favorite matchup in the entire game.
I can tell you who is who, because I was where... Because
you're sniping.
Ecop is the Druid.
I know who made which ban. So, Ecop banned Druid, and RDU banned
That's interesting. Banning Druid is such a thing that people are like not expecting, but I think it's a very powerful strategy considering how it fits in the pocket. Like, it can challenge Warrior... And Druid's pretty decent against Freeze Mage, which you anticipate a lot of this tournament. Because if you have Freeze Mage, you can ban its worst matchup, which is Control Warrior.
Yeah, you could ban Warrior and you probably get away with beating just about everything else.
So there's a lot of strategies with how you actually choose to ban and how you orient your lineup around it. So, maybe RDU's not even anticipating a Druid ban. He's like, well, I was expecting Warrior or Paladin to be banned. And now RDU is like in an awkward position where the Shade is going to have to take a hit here. He wants to develop like the Pilot Shredder, which is like if he doesn't develop it this turn, he's certainly not developing the following turn. But in the end, he needs to take care of the Shade now.
Yeah, and I feel like it's still not too bad because he's curving into high main next turn, followed by Pilot Shredder if he wants it. The thing is, Druid's also got their own tools. You know, with Freezing Trap not being there, a Fel Reaver is something you have to answer right now. Like, you could try to race, but with the Fel Reaver, if something gets taunted up, then you have to go through the taunt, and the Fel Reaver can just hit you repeatedly. So, I feel like the Fel Reaver being an addition to aggro decks, it's not even just good in Druid. It's just especially good there because of Innervate.
It's so scary to play Fel Reaver against Hunter sometimes because of Freezing Trap and the isolation, but you do have some chargers. So, the one thing is, like, Fel Reaver usually gets isolated, but in other decks like Mech Mage, but in Druid specifically, it feels like there's a lot of utility behind it. If you're not dropping it now, then when do you drop it? So, Lothar, why do you think Druid the Claw here is better versus Fel Reaver?
Did you talk about Hunter's Mark in example? Because for now, no one has any information about any kind of decks.
Well, he saw Argent Horus Rider, but that still doesn't mean any.
Yeah, it could be played in mid range still. It has been played. I mean, in this case, it is played in mid range.
Like, there's a possibility of two cards happening in the same slot as Hunter's Mark. The second one might be an Owl. The Owl is not a big problem against Fel Reaver, right? Because he doesn't care. So I guess he was worried about Hunter's Mark, but I think that's the only reason why you're worried about
it. Yeah, it makes sense.
It does make sense, yeah.
Well, are you thinking about, Ecop, thinking about, like, what's the best way you can set up Dr. Boom next turn? And Fel Reaver will draw a lot of damage. Even if High Main chooses not to trade, you still have opportunities to play Fel Reaver, hit the face, load up with Dr. Boom, and then threaten just a Savage Roar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the problem is here that even with the Savage Roar next turn eight, you might be just too slow.
Right, but in this case, I mean, there's also the option for RDU if he wants to use the High Main. Like, if Fel Reaver falls down to use the High Main and the Horse Rider to kill the Fel Reaver, I mean, that will mill the opponent through the Pilot Shredder and the Horse Rider just a little bit. Doesn't matter technically, but if you can, you've already seen one swipe, so the odds of your board getting cleaned up are pretty slim.
I mean, here the situation is like this. Ecop, I cannot really understand whether he's playing now Lotep when he was thinking about Fel Reaver, because Fel Reaver is way better. This way he practically says, I'll be trading next turn with my Lotep.
Yeah, I'll probably use it as a trading tool.
Keeper,
exactly.
I will keeper your Savannah Haime and trade or play Azure Drake and swipe. But
with an Innervate play, let's
but
say, right?
That's an aggressive Druid, so there's no Azure Drake, right? Because there are no card draws. So for RDU, there was a clear signal, I will do this. I will trade next turn. Because Lotep would be even better than Druid of the Claw next last turn.
Instead of playing the Druid of the Claw, you would play Lotep on that turn if you were trying to trade.
Exactly.
But now RDU, I mean, he's got I think that might be close enough to lethal.
That's 6 damage, 8.
11, 13.
One off, damage. I think. Right.
Well, you can just go for it.
Yeah, there's no reason not to, because the best he could do is, use Hero Power to get up to 2. You'd only die to something crazy like Force of Nature, Innervate, Savage Roar.
There's no Ancient of Lore.
Exactly.
So there's no heal apart from Hero Power.
The thing about using Kill Command now, though, is that he doesn't get the Beast activation, and his opponent already used Lotheb, so you know that Kill Command most likely will be able to be activated. The only problem is if he drew a second High Main, and he wouldn't be able to sweep into Hero Power, but that's still a very small fringe scenario.
Yeah, I mean, he would still get lethal off the Hero Power on its own.
Dude, imagine if he could get 3 juggles off Dr. Boom. That would've been nuts. But instead, he just has to play their next aspirin. Still looking pretty dicey, though, because he has to have 2 perfect juggles, and it still has to isolate like a really good target by doing this.
Well, that's the first one. That's awkward. Not what he wants to see. It's a little clunky.
He needs to shoot the 2-1 now, the left one.
Wow! Nice juggles.
Wow. Good stuff from Ecop. Really
doesn't mean he lives, but that's as good as...
Look at that.
Wow, missed BM. Quick shot. You're supposed to use it.
based off its condition.
Or maybe that's the, that is the BF.
Maybe that's it. I don't need the draw.
I was thinking about less than when he traded with the Partisan.
Instead
keeper,
of attacking phase.
Yes. Yeah. Was he worried about a double Savage Roar?
I think he was worried about... I don't think double Savage Roar
maybe,
killed
maybe
him.
Drew the Claw Savage Roar?
That didn't
he
kill
was
him
at 22.
Yeah. Oh, he was at 22. Was
22, and there was 3-2 creature, 2-4 creature.
He died to force Innervate Savage Roar, but that was it. From what I looked at, maybe I'm wrong, but... That's what I saw.
Yeah. So I think he's definitely just concerned about potentially dying.
Yeah.
Play it safe. Two Savage Roars is definitely possible. With that deck specifically, it's super aggressive. And he was also holding cards for a long time. Like, he held on to that Fel Reaver for a long time and other stuff. So he was probably concerned about, like, what kind of cards he's holding.
You've got a point, though, because, you know, the Druid of the Saber, that's a 2-drop. You can play with double Savage Roars pretty easily. So, yeah, that would have actually been lethal if he'd had those, so...
Well, Lothar's kind of pissed. I mean, RDU just lost.
No, RDU just won.
Oh, RDU you just won. Oh, you're right. Yeah, sorry. I did the overlay confused me for a while.
That's my face, man. I'm always pissed. I was traveling.
You have a resting bitch
today.
Face. That's cool, man. Yeah. That's cool. We all do.
They lost my baggage now.
Oh, yeah. They did? I'm sorry, man. That
they
sucks.
Lost
yeah,
it?
Yeah, no. It's like, oh, you're sorry. I'm sorry.
No, dude. I mean, I actually had some travel problems coming here, too, myself.
Yeah, I heard.
What happened to you?
Dude, I got frauded. I got IRL skmazed.
Really?
It's crazy.
What happened?
I think it was through what happened to Eloise, right? Like,
yeah, yeah. So what happened was I was traveling and then basically just classic con stuff. And then I got some guy charged me $2,000 three times from a woman clothing store. He got the right criteria down how to make it look like me, but I would never be caught dead shopping there. So
it's the blue dye that gave it away.
It is.
Wow.
Thankfully, all that got sorted out, though, so I'm okay. Right. Warrior, by the way, this is not looking like a regular control warrior. It looks like the patron warrior.
Which has to be like good against, like, something of an aggressive hunter, but because this is more of a mid-range one, you know, if the curve lines up for the hunter and the high main comes out on time, then he's more than fine. I mean, face hunter is definitely weak to a deck like this, but not so much this one.
Sure, makes sense. And he got some really good information. The freezing trap ended up bouncing back here. The cruel taskmaster, so that's good for Ekop. Now he can use that cruel taskmaster again to pick off some of these smaller minions.
I mean, this is kind of a little pesky minion to deal with, but the ghoul does it on its own, so it really there's nothing really to worry about. I kind of like the horse rider. It's a card that I was very excited about when I saw it. And I'm happy that it's being played like in Rogue, you know, in Oil Rogue for a while. It's like a lot of play.
Yeah, it's often used just as an alternative to just pressure.
Yeah.
Because Divine Shield is so annoying to deal with that even though you're giving up an attack compared to Wolf Rider, the fact is if you just like play it and not even trade, like you attack face, your opponent just has a problem dealing with it. So it's a very annoying minion. Only trumped by Unstable Ghoul, which is just as annoying, if not even more.
Yeah, it's the card that changed. I remember back when Control Warrior ran that card.
That
Unstable
like,
Ghoul?
Wow.
Yeah. That was like back when Zoo was their weakness.
It's OG, man.
Yeah, it was so good.
Look at that. No Glaive Zooka value. In fact, based off the sequencing, RDU could have...
Gotten
the buff on the Mad Scientist. So a little small misstep that could have happened. It was a 50-50.
He didn't attack with the Glaive Zooka, so he... Otherwise, he would have
attack
with the Glaive Zooka.
You're right, he buffed
so
the
damage.
Yeah, right. What are we talking about?
Yeah, you're right. Makes sense.
Yeah. No, you're right.
Well, I mean, it depends on what you want. I mean, you
can
get
the extra
damage.
Well, he doesn't have a second weapon now, so he wants the damage.
Yeah, so it makes sense. It's just like a +1 damage, -1 damage in other areas.
Mm-hmm. But at the same
it
time,
all goes
you have additional.
It still
right.
goes phase, yeah. Instead of wasting one damage, you're going to need that extra bit of damage off your weapon.
Maybe not exactly as a finisher,
right?
Because this is the midrange hunter, you can use the 2 damage just to trade with a minion. So this might be important in this case.
All right, well, I mean, the warrior's still in such a good spot. He hasn't even used Armorsmith yet, and he has Whirlwinds available, so it's like... Almost whatever the hunter puts out, is the warrior's gonna be able to deal with it pretty easily.
Yeah, I mean the Leox is not even bad here. Look at that.
That's a good one.
Leox gets a good trade, but then he's trading with the Shredder, which gives him a lot of
like leeway still.
Yeah, but Arduin is just 7 high mains. Like, to ensure that you can win against the Patron Warrior, which is the best deck against aggro in general, is to get the 7 high mains, because they are the heavy hitters. Heavy hitters against against Warrior, and without that card, I don't think you can even win this matchup, because Patron has so many answers to just gain, you know, armor, board control with whirlwinds, or whatever can happen with the unstable ghouls. You have so many answers to whatever is happening to the board.
Yeah, but it's like, if you're playing just what a Facehunter would play, then you're still weak to Patron, right? Like, if your plays consist of all the 2-drops and the 1-drops that Facehunter would play, then playing mid-range doesn't give you an edge, so you really have to hit those mid-game minions.
Sure, makes sense.
Yeah, it's just...
What do you think about playing, like, the cool Taskmaster?
Wow. Oh, look at that. I just was...
That's pretty convenient and on time.
No, RDU's
smiling. He's like, yeah, I totally outscaled you.
Oh, that's the RDU face if I ever had one where it's like, I totally didn't. I totally earned that draw.
Oh, God.
I skillfully whipped that high main off the top of my deck.
He's like, I practiced a lot.
Dude, I mean, RDU is one of the hard, like, he's try hard to you. That's his nickname on ladder. The guy is like, even if it's point, like, okay, so one time I was laddering with RDU and he was coaching me and helping me, and he was like telling me not to concede even though like my opponent has full lethal on board and like there's no way I can win, because he says there's always a chance that person recognizes who you are and gives you a free win.
Oh my god.
And that's that's so RDU. Like, the fact that he'll even hold out at this 0.01% chance that not only will the guy recognize RDU but like him enough to concede. He's like, don't do it, Frodo. I was like, all right.
He's like, you have more chances than me. You should know that.
I mean, that's kind of how it is. But, you know, that high name was really big.
Try hard to you.
Try hard to you.
Try hard to you. In my country, in Romania. Oh, my God. I love
RDU. My first girlfriend was Romanian. This is true. This accent is true.
Gotcha. All right, because I forgot that Noxious is married.
Yeah.
He actually went the full distance.
I don't even know what happened.
You are more of a man than all 32 players here. Actually, Lothar is married.
I'm married, yeah, right. Yeah,
actually, Nif just got engaged, so we have a lot of people who are...
Engaged is not yet married.
Is it not?
It's a next step, though.
Yeah.
It's like...
It's like, it goes like this.
Like marriage is Patron Warrior pre-nerf.
Yeah.
And right, and like, and then, you know, like, you know, engaged is kind of like, you know, freeze mage status.
Oh my God.
If you have it, if you're just like single, like you're a Raynad, you're still like dipping around in Hunter.
Around, I see.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that high mage changed everything, like you were talking about. It's so powerful. He doesn't have execute to deal with it. Instead, he has to rely on just fighting back with minions.
Yeah, but he has Grim Patron now.
But is it too late? I mean, there's just, what trap is it, by the way? We know that freezing
trap is one of them. Because there are so many possibilities.
It could be freezing, is my guess. I mean, then again, it could be, like, there's a lot of mixes nowadays that happen.
Yeah, freezing has been a lot of times mixed with snake traps these days, because it's a really good split with how you interact with your board. But then you also can see double freezing quite often as well. Those are both problematic.
And
that is not a problem for sure. He needs to armor up and hope that 2 damage isn't drawn off the top.
And now it's a boar with 1 attack.
Oh wow.
Wrecked. I mean, so okay, even if that flame tongue wasn't there,
it was
he still would have had enough, right?
Yeah.
Would he? No.
He would have. 4 plus the hero.
Yeah, plus the hero. Yeah. So it would have. And the fact is now he has 4 overkill because of that flame tongue. Fun stuff, but that means the Hunter is 2-0, just like old times. We're back.
Yeah.
Hearthstone Esports is back. We want Hunter to sweep every series.
It's funny because, you know, a lot of pros really like Last Hero Standing a lot more.
Yeah,
than, like,
so they say.
Well, I mean,
yeah, this will change after this turn.
Yeah.
I feel like rose-colored glasses, right? Because I remember the days when people complained about just pure sweeps, but I wonder if it was more of the, you know, the viewer experience sometimes. Like, you want to see new stuff.
I mean, it was because back then in Last Hero Standing, there was a consensus that one deck was just wildly overpowered.
Yeah,
whether it was Undertaker Hunter or Miracle Rogues or...
Handlog sometimes.
Like the Zoo Warlock was really good. And back then, also in Last Hero Standing, aggro wasn't very common outside of just 2 decks. It was actually Zoo and Hunter.
And,
How did you play aggro back then? Like, you had to play, like, like backspace rogue.
Oh my god!
And you had to play like
that was like a typical rogue aggro deck. Yeah. Which nowadays it doesn't even exist. Like yeah. Anymore,
I mean, really. We can see a recurrence of that theme mm-hmm. of aggro tempo rogue.
With yeah, for sure.
With a new. What's his name of the raptor?
Unearthed Raptor.
The Unearthed Raptor.
I want to say fossil Pokemon, but yeah.
Fossil Pokemon, yeah, that's good, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, there's many more aggro options these days, which is pretty cool to see variety of it. However, now, because the Conquest format has introduced, like, it almost became somewhat irrelevant. It became more about if you want to target versus right. what you bring.
Yeah. It's funny because Secret Paladin is so good on ladder, but then you bring it to a tournament system, like to a tournament in Conquest, and it just doesn't target anything. So
yeah,
you don't
want
to play it.
Makes sense. All right, well, 2-0 lead for RDU. And remember, this is group stage, so for all those ECOP fan out there, if he loses this... If he loses
all
this, I meant exactly what I said.
Okay, sure.
Even if he loses this, he still has a chance. To go through.
Yeah, he has to win against who?
Well, ECOP is in a group with Eloise and Vortex.
And RDU.
So, actually, Eloise versus Vortex is coming up on stream after this. They started Group B first, which is interesting. I thought they were starting Group A with Firebat and Purple. That would have been a really cool group to see. That said, by the way, we have all four groups from the first half going to be happening today. There's also a B stream happening. You can go to tagdv.net and find out all the streams. I actually don't know the B stream link off the top of my head.
What happens on the B stream?
The B stream, I believe it would be groups like Orange, Stansifka, Toyota, and Surrender. And then I'm guessing Group A is going to be happening simultaneously. I'll have to double check with the admins. So that's Firebat, Purple, Cypher, and Martin Creek. A little unlucky because I want to see Firebat versus Purple in the mainstream. That would have been really sick. I'm looking at the groups, guys. You should commentate the match.
I was gonna go there.
Jet lag.
Yeah, I'm more jet lagged than.
Well, we
only at Sea Story Cubs that a legitimate
excuse. Yeah, because you come in, you just go to work.
Yeah.
Well, work.
I arrived 6 a.m. today in Frankfurt. I had to take a train today to Düsseldorf to take...
From Poland to Germany? Poland. Are you seriously arguing a one-hour time jet lag difference?
Dude, I'm going
from...
He was in Blizzcon.
USA. All right.
He was there with you, Frodo.
You're right.
Frodo's like, I don't remember that.
What the hell is happening? Right.
That Polish guy casting with me. He's going to clean up the Doomsayer. I mean, I guess ultimately you have to put on aggression against the mage. And even if that means you waste quote-unquote 7 damage, if that forces him to use more removal to deal with your board, it's probably worth it. I just feel like it's a very difficult matchup to win. And with the Explosive Sheep on top, it's even tougher.
Well, you know, he has cards like Lotheb, which can really help a lot. And Savannah Highmane is still such a big problem to the point where I know some Freeze Mages were... Just like, you know, they're just like ice lancing high mains over and over because that's the only way they can stall for time. And even if they die, like through Doomsayer or Fireball, the hyenas come out and it's only 2 power less. So, ECOP instead choosing to use Freeze on the Leoc, and that you might think that's kind of an overreaction, but he knows there's Argent Horse Riders, there's Arcane Golems, and Leoc buffing those damage would be a big problem too.
Yep. I don't like using the load up here, to be honest.
I would prefer
the Shredder. Just to lock the turn when there might be a flame strike or a second ice block or whatever happening, just to prevent the game from turning around, you know?
Yeah, there are some key turns you want to make sure you don't play Lotheb. Like, you don't want to play it on 6. You don't want to play it on 9 because then it's Emperor Thorsen, Alex Strauss anyways. Yeah. Turn 5 is, like, iffy. If you have a big board, you can prevent Frost Nova Doomsayer, which is really big.
But you know your opponent will be pinging.
The Leoc.
So he will have only 3 mana.
That's true. I mean, with that Dino Straw, that gives him something to do, too. Like, Explosive Sheep just on the board wouldn't be very good.
Yeah. But for curving, I mean, to curve, the Lotheb is better, because you do get to play the Shredder afterwards with Hero Power or Glaivezuka.
By the way, who did the overlay? Bob Ross?
Bob Ross did the overlay. I know, it was... commissioned.
That'd be great.
Twitch.
Watching Bob Ross paint Hearthstone stuff and talk about being happy.
We're gonna put a happy little tree in the
like happy little trees, displays, exactly. And it's like, no, man, that's not happy at all.
The 3 little melons.
Oh, look at that. No pink for the leader.
Yeah, so we opted to play Heobot instead because it's more mana efficient. However, it does have less impact. Not only is it only healing 7, but you also leave up Leoc.
Yeah.
and you know that you're taking additional 3 from that. So the effect of Healbot is usually higher. And not to mention that he does have Ice Barrier, though, so maybe he feels more comfortable like taking some damage now and then letting Ice Barrier be played later after he starts chaining things like freezes and whatnot.
Yeah, one of the things as well with the Healbot is that it's a lot more expensive than Ice Barrier.
Yeah, that's true.
So that's also something you have to keep in mind.
It's also a 3/3 health minion that can absorb some stuff.
I mean, if the Leog here hadn't been buffed by Glaivzuka, it was really clunky for RDU to deal with it because he would have had to trade the Leog and the Glaivzuka hit or use the Lothab, which then died to Blizzard. So
I wonder if RDU feels like threatened enough to Blizzard, or he can even play Emperor Thorsen.
If he healed up last turn, maybe his plan was to get the Emperor out.
But the problem is that he go down to 9 health, and then Ice Barrier probably doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
So, and he definitely is reconsidering, like, can he drop down Emperor Thorsen? You know, what does it even open up by playing it? Do you have an opportunity to squeeze in better tempo plays, or will you survive? All those things aren't very likely because Hunter has been able to put pressure, but he knows that Hunter's down to 1 card. So if he can survive this pressure, then he'll be stuck top decking.
Yeah, like no high main, please. And even then, you know, he does have 2 freezes on the back end. So even if there's a high main that shows up, he can still at least stall for a little bit.
But he knows there's a high main because there was no high main in 10-6, right?
Right, right. It would have been short over the Shredder. Although he did have to kill the
the
3/3 Healbot
to
deny a good Blizzard. So maybe there was a good argument to be made for not playing it. Just don't top deck in RDU.
It depends on how things will pan out here. Arjun Horse Rider helps him fill out the mana curve. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
And this is the point where, like, if he can get his opponent's health down, oh my goodness, I mean, if he can get his opponent's health down quick enough, because he's going to do 10 more damage here, assuming he doesn't kill the Thanos, then Ice Barrier doesn't really do much if you can just hero power down, and then you might not even have to be reliant on popping it. You could just use direct damage and burn.
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, Blizzard here is really terrible. I mean, it works in that it will stall, but how to wipe this board if you're...
That's pretty big.
Wow, okay, that's massive.
Yeah, that's really huge.
I mean, you probably will heal for about... 4 you can now because you have 2 ice barriers and you probably want to use that on 10-7 and 8.
Right.
So I guess you won't heal as much as you would like with the Alexstrasza, but at the same time.
Would you Nova here? Would you go like Ice Barrier Nova, then go Blizzard Explosive Sheep to set up a good trade with the sheep afterwards?
I mean it's a shame that he didn't play the Emperor this turn. It would change a lot, in my opinion.
It would have at least forced a trade from the Lothab or from the Shredder that was there.
I don't think so.
It would have at least forced a trade of some sort, just based on...
It would just change the turns with 2 mana Ice Barrier, 2 mana Frost.
Right.
Yeah, it does. It does, and especially Alexstrasza comes, like, because now he would have another turn with it. Alexstrasza would guarantee come the next turn.
God.
2 high mains is a lot of pressure, and the big thing is that he already has 6 damage on board, so the Ice Barrier effectively cancels out. The only thing is that problematic is the Explosive Sheep. It might actually help a really easy board clear.
Which is exactly what you're looking for. Like, the Explosive Sheep is not something you... I mean, sometimes you get a really good value from just playing it and pinging it. But very often, late game, when you get it set up before Blizzard, when you know they're going to rush you down, it's better.
But he does have some Death Rattle minions, so, like, it's very complicated because this Sheep wants to kill off, like, you know... I mean, every minion is sticky in some capacity.
Right. You'd have to attack the... if you wanted to attack anything here, like, you might Blizzard and then attack the high main. You would pop everything and leave Hyenas. But Hyenas are dangerous, you know, with kill command possibilities.
Too bad for Ikub that the Sheep and Death Rattle is triggered first.
Yeah,
that's true.
Was played after that.
Right.
Because otherwise, we would just Force Nova, Ice Lens, the Savannah Hyena, and attack into that to clear the board effectively.
Well, he could Blizzard Ice Lance if he wants, and he can
still use Frost Nova this turn. I think he can also maybe consider using Emperor and like after he trades, he can play Emperor and Ice Lance to high main.
You only dead something like Iron Beak Owl with Kill Command, let's say, where the high main is unsilenced.
Okay.
I mean, it's silenced.
So Frost Nova here, but then
Ice Barrier again, I guess.
I don't like this at all. I mean, I would still prefer the Blizzard turn, so you can Blizzard first and.
Whoa, if he goes for this.
Well, this is ballsy or really bad? I don't know.
I mean, I didn't look at the Order of Death Rattles, but I feel like there was a possibility for the Blizzard Icelands.
Well, yeah, there was.
Or, I mean, even Nova Icelands ping and then trade the sheep. I mean, you do leave the 2-drop and the Shredder and the 2-1.
It does feel excessive that he Icelanced
the Jaime.
Because he still has, like, Blizzard, and he could use that later on. Although, now he's just going to Blizzard again.
And is going to stall. It's actually going to do what he wants, I guess. He wanted to get the Hyenas out for the Blizzard. That's probably the line of thinking.
Oh, interesting. RDU holds on to the Leper Gnome. He wants to use it as, like, final damage, maybe, to, like, play around Flame Strikes and whatnot.
Play around Flame Strikes?
It plays, like, forces play the around, Mage, not
any,
the...
Yeah, right. You're right.
Well, he's used both of his high mains. That's usually the highest curve for a hybrid Hunter deck. And he does have the Argent Horsefighter put on more pressure. Now he knows both Ice Barriers have been pulled out, which means it's pretty much Ice Blocks guaranteed, outside of the very, very small possibility that it's duplicate in a Freeze Mage deck.
Yeah, Nerea style.
Yeah, that's right. But Ecop's not that... I mean, it's very rare for Freeze Mages to run that.
It's pretty cool. I just want to see after the advent of League of Explorers what Freeze Mage will become, because it looks like it could change quite a bit. Depending on where players want to take it.
Yeah, so Reno Jackson, at least on paper, would be amazing in the Freeze Mage Mirror.
Hmm. That's pretty solid.
Wait, why would you play Alex Straza here?
So, Alex...
I like Emperor Alex more than Alex. If I'm going to play Alex, I'm going to Emperor first. But...
Do you
would take 8 from those two guys and then another 2. So you have to dodge 1 extra damage in order to not get your Ice Block popped. And that's
on. Well, I mean, what about Leper Gnome popping?
Yeah, well, that's the thing. You would have to ping the 2-1 right now, right? Like the Horse Rider. And then you will be taking.
Yeah, you'd be taking 10.
Yeah, I mean, you can Alex.
You're taking 10 with the assumption that he doesn't draw more damage, like you said.
Right. Oh, he didn't draw it, so in this case, that was actually correct.
But the problem is, even if he Alex draws it himself. He can't really do anything outside of that Alexstrasza turn, and there's still going to be 14 damage coming on the other way.
Yeah, I don't think there's a way out of
Heal-Bot
this.
Heal-Bot, I mean, top deck would be sick.
He already used his Heal-Bot.
Okay, that helps.
That was big.
Yeah, that's actually really a lot. Massive.
And then Emperor...
works again. Get
I mean, Blizzard for 4 mana doesn't give you, like, Antonitis combo potential, but it's
still
really
powerful. Would
you
trade the high main first, then? I mean, you would still freeze the high main. Maybe you pop the Shredder, see what's inside. You could even ping...
You have to go aggressive. Like, you have to Ice Lance and then use Alexstrasza to hit face. So you have 18 damage dealt.
You know what's funny?
That might give you Pyroblast.
Sorry.
Pyroblast, sorry. Please continue
further. I was just saying, like, if he chooses to go for this, he still can Pyroblast for the win. So, yeah.
He's going for it. But he's offering trades.
Right. So, like, Hunter can now clear the board. Yeah. Oh, no, he can't.
He can't kill everything.
He's 1 damage off from doing that.
Oh,
now he can.
Yeah, there's no way. There's no way he doesn't, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But now, before he can clear the board and pop with just hero power, which is really powerful, and ideally, he'd also be able to do this without using his Leper Gnome, so that way Blizzard is lethal, too.
Right.
Yeah. I was seeing something that's happening.
Wow.
Nice. Very, very good juggle there and outcome. Because now if he even deals with Leper Gnome for some weird reason, then he can also get more juggles.
Insane. Absolutely insane.
Well, the juggles for both players were just insane.
Yeah, that was really good. That was really good.
But now what are you
Pyroblast?
No. That's it.
GG. There's really no way out of this. That Leper Gnome... Oh, also the fact that he can't stop damage, but that's it.
RDU 3-0 with Hunter.
Field and Days, they're back.
It's the 90s.
What do we think about that? Who's a pro player that can
I don't know if I miss it.
I love the hey.
Just FYI.
Hey, dude.
Players aren't even looking. Like, I was trying to tell them.
They don't care. They don't care.
No, they're too busy talking about how that was very skillful
RDU
series.
Cares. Yeah.
I mean, RDU played really well.
Yeah, that was solid.
Which, to all fairness, Ecop is my friend, but he didn't play well this series.
Ooh! Well, you know
Shots
what?
Fired.
I'm going to make sure Ecop casts your series, Lothar.
Of course.
And
of course
I will make sure nobody casts mine. That will be banned.
I'll cast it. I'll just say, that's still better than me.
Yeah. Hey, RDU.
RDU.
Come over here.
Hey.
All right, now get ready for a 5-minute diatribe on what he did wrong and what he could
squeeze
do. All right. So, RDU, come over here. So how did you feel about that series? 103-0, last hero standing, just like old times, right?
Well, I cannot really remember the last time I drew like this in my entire career.
The high main off the top,
return
six.
All the series, like first two games were like 1-3 in the starting hand. Like having 1-3 in the starting hand is so rare. It feels good, man.
Yeah, it feels pretty good. I mean, generally speaking, you were talking about how you put a lot of preparation to this tournament. Was it specifically in the lineups here? Like, did you anticipate that Hunter would be that dominant against a lineup like Ecop? Or do you think, like, his strategy was weird because he banned your Druid to start things off?
No. First of all, I think that my lineup covers almost everything. Like, even the worst things, I can still have two decks and get a bit lucky and have favorable matchups. The only thing I'm not happy about this series is that I played around too many things in the last game. Like when I went for the trade with the Mad Scientist with the Horse Rider, I played around him having Flame Strike, and then he could like trade Scientist and then ping my high main Flame Strike. I really wanted to have the high main unchallenge, so in case he has Flame Strike, I get the two twos. But I didn't realize that by trading, if he pings the Horse Rider, I need to top deck damage. And then I put myself in a really bad spot.
Yeah.
So I went for, like, I played around too many things in the last game. I shouldn't have done that.
He still had an out at the very final turn, which was, like, kind of scary, right? With the Pyroblast.
Pyroblast.
And still, in the first game, I should have went first with the Shredder and not trading the Keeper.
Yeah, we were confused
about that, too.
I was like, I thought I was in such a good spot that the only thing I can lose to is Innervate combo. So I wanted to play around that, too. But then he actually had, like, Knife Juggler, and he put himself in a good spot, so he forced me to top deck. But half of my deck or more like was top deck, so I was happy.
But you dodged, you kind of dodged like the. There was one thing that killed you, maybe two. We looked at, so it was kind of
okay.
It was a good play. It was fine.
It was fine.
It was justifiable.
I could have played better. It's just like the first game of the tournament. I will play better in the next ones. I promise.
Try hard.
All right. Well, we look forward to it. What do you think about the other half of your group? You have Eloise and Vortex. Was Ecop the hardest opponent that you had to get past?
I would say yes.
Okay.
But the others are really good too.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay, so some respect here from RDU.
Yeah.
That's
right. All right. Yeah, I think Ecop is like...
He's growing up, man. Yeah. I met RDU when he was 17. He was just like...
I'm better than everyone. My lineup covers
everything.
I'm from
Romania. I'm the best player in my country.
I really think that Ecop is super underrated. Like, everybody thinks he's bad, but he's actually on a really high skill level. Mm-hmm. So... He's nothing to be underestimated.
Absolutely, I agree. I think Ecop's still one of the players that I'd peg to potentially advance, even though he lost his first match. Yeah. So congrats, RDU.
Thank you very much. Won your first series.
You started off on a very good footing. Lothar approves on behalf of G2. Congrats. Do you want to have any final things you want to say?
You want to raise?
There you go.
Big shout out to my team and big shout out to my practice group, which is like Crane and Super JJ.
That's great.
Super JJ.
He'll be playing in my group, in Group G, so you helped him prep.
He's got Hunter.
I'm not feeling very good, man. I'm not feeling very good about that.
It's going to hurt. It's going to hurt.
That's right. Well, RDU, you already have completely turned around your performance this Seed Story Cup, because last Seed Story Cup didn't go very well, but this one is off to a good start. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to have more action here from the Take TV Studios in Krefeld, Germany. Stay tuned. Be right back.